It is my great honor to introduce our speaker for the evening. That is John Feldkamp. I have had the honor of working with John for the past 5 years. In fact, one of the smarter things I did when I came on board as the director of the Honors College was to lure John away from the University of Michigan to come to work with me in the Honors College. Being in the Honors College, I think, is the absolute perfect place for John to be. Not only is he an EMU graduate, he's a graduate of the Honors College. And while in the Honors College, John did just about anything and everything that a college student can do. He studied abroad. He worked as an intern shadowing the EMU president at the time, John Fallon. He pursued university and departmental honors in two completely different disciplines, finishing a thesis in literature and a thesis in mathematics. He met the love of his life, whom he later had the good sense to marry, or vice versa. And he completed his senior thesis, and now we are able to see how many times people have downloaded those. It's been really, really cool. John almost pursued a career in secondary education, but again, the lure of higher ed was just really too strong. He completed a master's degree at the University of Michigan, went on to work at the University of Michigan before coming to Eastern. I don't know very many people who know the names of every single student in their college and most of their schedules over a period of years, but John does. Over the last 5 years, I've come to see firsthand over and over again how we've benefited from his intelligence, his enthusiasm, his passion, and in many cases, his courage. I personally think his story is fascinating. I'll let him share that himself. When he's finished tonight, there will be hopefully a few minutes for some questions and answers, and I hope you'll be here for that. Join me in welcoming our speaker, John Feldkamp.
Well, Becky just covered a lot of the content for this evening, so thank you for that, making my job easy. I also think it's worth pointing out, since I know some of you probably already saw it, but I'm already off to a great start this evening. When you get ready for a presentation, and what slide do you focus least on? It's probably that first slide with just your name on it, and I already saw that I misspelled my name to start. Now it's correctly spelled, so hopefully I'm good to go now. Hopefully there's no other spelling errors either. But with that, I'm really excited to be here. When Becky first approached me with the opportunity to speak in the Star Lecture Series, I was thrilled, I was honored. Last year I had the chance to be on a panel with individuals across the university. It was a real pleasure for me. And for me personally, seeing the Star Lecture Series from the beginning of when we started having this as a program opportunity for our honor students and then at the larger scale for the university as well, I think it's just symbolic of where we are now as an honors college. Seeing this place go from an honors program and what we did, and I think there was a lot of really great things that we had to offer, but I think this is something that we can be really proud of and to see the development of this as well. So for me, when I was first asked to put this together, what I wanted to focus on in my Star Lecture, I had a lot of different ideas of what could I do, what could I talk about, how much to go and do research, how much to go investigate a new topic, seeing our wonderful individuals across the campus community, our faculty bringing in discipline content, our president talking about, our provost and interim president, Dr. Schatzel, talking about her life experiences as well. And that really meant a lot to me. And so for me, when I started putting this together, I started to think about what would I like to talk about? Well, of course, and then I can hear my graduate assistants in my ear right now saying, well, he's going to want to talk about himself. So of course, I took that advice. And I had a lot of fun with this as well, because even just putting this together, and it's one of those things, I was thinking of Pat Berry's last talk here, of trying to be perfect, but sometimes you just gotta be damn good. And so at the end, otherwise words offered to me back in my undergrad years from Dr. Sandy Norton, a paper's never done, it's just due. And so I think I just had to embrace that. And I'm glad, and someone's heard that before as well in the audience, I'm glad to hear that as well. So finally, I started putting this together a little bit more and having to commit to what I actually wanted to do versus like all the great ideas I had thought. I'm like, oh, that's a great quota. That's a good subject to cover. And so finally had to just go for it. And I think something that really means a lot to me with this presentation as well is that when you do this job long enough, you start to really find your way into this place of neutrality, objective thought, really trying to leave a big part of yourself out of personal bias from situations and really trying to view things objectively. And for me, this was a really nice opportunity to put something together because it does have a big part of me. Becky already talked on this, and we'll get to it here in a little bit, but this Honors College and this university has given me so much. And so being able to have the opportunity to give so much of me into this presentation tonight is just something that really means a lot to me as well, and I'm looking forward to it. So tonight, talking about the topic that I have here, the conflicts we have with our identities while pursuing a well-lived life, I started to think about that theme, and I know we've rolled with it for a couple years now, and that one really resonated to me because of thinking about my life journey and what I've gone through to get to where I am. And I think it's one of those things too. I think naturally this title is maybe assumed that there's this idea that there's these speakers that get up and they've got this life figured out and they've got it all worked. Maybe they work too hard all their life and they realize they gotta step back and enjoy the small things a little bit more. And I think, yeah, that's a little bit of what's in here as well. But I think the idea of the journey of how one gets there and realizes it, and that sometimes these decisions that we come to aren't always the easiest. And sometimes looking back on it, maybe you would have done something differently. Maybe you wish you would have done something differently. Maybe you're not sure exactly what you're doing is right, but you more or less just got to go for it. And so for me, one of the topics that I'll be talking about tonight is food. I was thinking about how to start this, diets and trendy diets and this idea of how does one eat healthy. And one of the trendiest things that you'll ever see in papers or news articles is how to eat healthy. And looking at food and breaking down food. Is it low carbs? Is it low fat? Is it low sugar? Is it high protein? Is it high quantities of vegetables? And this idea that you can take a piece of food and you can break it down into biochemistry, essentially, or into its whole food elements, and you can find this silver bullet ingredient that makes something healthy, I think kind of misses the point of how one can eat healthy and maybe more generally live healthy. It's typically with food or with food in general, it's the holistic food and it's the combinations of things. And it's not so much does this one thing make me healthy or does it make me unhealthy? It's that the pattern and the combination of it all. And so for me, thinking about what determines a well-lived life, this idea that you can break down your life into binary code, and naturally that's sometimes what I want to do with the math background in me, but at the same time you have to take it all for who you are, and so maybe sometimes you get something right, maybe sometimes you get it wrong, but at the end of the day when you look back and see where you are, that's kind of what you are, and you get what you get at that point. So for me, embracing all the occupational therapy talk that I hear in my house, and I feel like maybe there's like a bachelor's degree or an associate's degree, I guess it technically is for OT that you can get, but I feel like I've been earning one as I've been going along this journey with my wife in the OT program here. I really started thinking about what did I want to, in the spirit of breaking things down, what did I want to focus on tonight and look at for myself and my identity and where I am. So I took what I identified as identities and within there, focusing on an occupation within that and more or less talking about how that specific occupation with that identity has shaped me into who I am and influenced me as part of it. Yesterday when Becky and I were talking about the presentation, I have to cite, we're an academic, so I have to do a good job of citing things. Talking with Becky yesterday about my presentation, I think she really did nail it as far as this mosaic painting, as far as these diverse elements on a canvas that sort of more or less come together and maybe viewing them individually. It's what you'd expect, but when you put it together, it's more or less a unique story. And I think, and when we get to the end here, I mean, and that's part of the thing, is that we all have a unique story to tell, and when we put it all together. As promised, Marissa, I remembered that I'd like you right now in your program, if you can, I think as we go through this journey together, at least looking at my story, I'd like it if you would do the same in your program as well. Maybe jot down 2 to 4 identities that you find to be your most salient, most important, things that you are aware of most frequently. and maybe the occupations that are within that identity as well. So I'm going to start with professional because I feel like that really more or less overarches my life here. And I feel like it's one of the things that I, when I think back in terms of where I got to and in terms of, and Becky already touched on it, in terms of how does one be, and this question I get in my job as well, as far as like, well, how does one work in higher ed, or how does one get involved in honors, or how did you become the associate director in honors? And I think, you know, having, there's not a prereqs in order to do that, I think it's just an individual journey. But with mine, I think it's kind of a fun one to share. So for me, I was created in this world with it's a boy. My father was so excited that he had a son that he was going to be able to transition the farm over to in my family. So I come from a family of farmers on the border of Saline and Clinton. As you can tell, I think it's fitting the conflicts with our identities. I'm pretty sure at that point my dad should have been planning on a new plan with his next farm, or who's going to take over the farm after him. As I can see, looking at this picture, being a farmer wasn't exactly what I think I was most excited about. And that was my first introduction to pigs. So I think it's kind of one of those things with parents. It's kind of like, oh, this is going to be so cute. We're going to put these pigs in front of them, and it's going to be so awesome. And I, as you can see, I was quite thrilled with the situation put in front of me. The other part, so I come from a family of farmers, but I also think the other part that I like to highlight as well is that I come from a family of musicians. My mother has a master's degree in music education, and so when I was less than a year old, my sister was going around the house and she was closing the doors, and so I had my hand in the doorway in my house, and she slammed the door shut, and I lost my pinky, and it was literally hanging on by a piece of skin. As they drove me to the hospital to try to take care of, this is in the 80s, so I'm really intrigued, let alone in this. And so they brought me into the hospital, and the doctor looked at my parents and said, well, he's just gonna have a stub for a pinky for the rest of his life. And my mom, just this blood-curdling scream of, but he has to be able to play the violin. And so, even though I don't play the violin, I am happy that I do have a pinky with me tonight, this evening. But I think my mom would be as well, but I think I start off by saying this as far as before I even started too far into this world, it was kind of coming from a music family, coming from a farming family, this idea that I was going to have music and farming be a really big part of my life, that was just something that was assumed. My second slide here I have is sports. And sports was always a really important part. I would say probably still is a really important part of my life. For me, sports really represented quite a few different things for me. For example, on the bottom right-hand picture here, this is me with my fellow co-captains back in the day. People may recognize the middle person there, number 71, that's Ken Bowen. He graduated from EMU last year. He's also in the service. And so we played football together. And for me, I learned a lot about myself playing football. I learned, for example, that, so in football, there's an offense and a defensive side. And on the offense, you have the chance to develop plays and you have to decide what you're going to do beforehand. And on defense, you more or less have to react to what the offensive players are doing. And so for me, I realized through that experience and looking back on it and really to where I am now, I really realized that I am much better at visualizing and preparing in advance versus reacting. So I wasn't the greatest of linebackers in the day and age, but I really did. I did well at fullback. I did well at tight end. And I also played quarterback as well. And just the ability to prepare for something in advance and visualize what you were doing beforehand, that was something that was really helpful for me. The other thing that regarding sports, basketball was something that really meant a lot to me as well. That's something that my father and I connected over quite a bit. I would go to school typically with him in the morning. He was a custodian for 38 years at Saline Area Schools. And when he was working, before I took the bus to school, I would just play basketball, and sometimes he'd stop over and we'd play a little bit as well. But it was having that shared experience with my dad really meant a lot to me as well. And also the fact that with sports, it was something, and I'll talk about it in a minute when I get to a couple slides here, it was a place that I could do something that I really loved to do, and that was math. Because even now, more and more, I think there's even graduate programs now emerging for this statistical analysis in sports, and more or less that's becoming a bigger thing. Anybody who saw the movie Moneyball Mathematics is just all over in sports, and so that's something else that I really enjoyed about it. The other thing that really meant a lot to me is with sports is the fact that looking back, I realized how fortunate I am that I had the privilege to be able to play sports, because when I was in third grade, I was in a really severe car accident with my mom on my way to school one day, and our car flipped 3 times. If I would have been in the back, I would have had a TBI or a severe head injury, at least, maybe not even survived it. Multiple people in the accident came away with physical disabilities after the fact, and the fact that I walked away with nothing. I do have the scar, maybe people have noticed it over the years, that's right here. That is what I have to remind myself of that situation. But for me, I always viewed sports as a real privilege to be a part of, and that just the opportunity to be involved in something. I still did incorporate music in my life. I think anybody who's ever in the marching band is obligated to have one of those photos holding the trumpet. So my mom and I would always have these great discussions, we'll frame it as discussions, around the idea of if I should continue to be in music or not, because that was something that was really important to her. And for me, when I remember going to high school, and I remember we had really healthy discussions around the idea of if I should be doing marching band and playing football as I started high school. And she really insisted that I try it for 1 year. And so I did do it for 1 year, and I did keep music as part of my life. And lo and behold, mom knows best, because I did it again my second year in high school as well. And being in marching band while playing football is an interesting schedule. I mean, looking back, I don't know how I did it. Getting up and doing marching band in the morning, playing football at night, and then some days doing marching band after football as well. But I really, when I was thinking back to what did I gain from that experience the most, and now is so also playing the trumpet. What's really exciting when you're playing the trumpet in middle school is that's the time when I had braces, and there's nothing more exciting than starting your band. And I already hear some laughing, so you know this is going. There's nothing more exciting than starting your band performance with putting that wax on your braces before you play. Any trumpet players in the crowd? Any wax wearers as well? So for me, during that time, it was this time in my life where it's like a really critical part where you're forming your embouchure, and that's how you're the shape of your mouth for playing the notes. And so when I was learning how to play, I had my braces, and so I could never play the high notes. And so typically those who could play higher were the ones who were seated higher in the trumpet section as well. And so for me, even though I couldn't play the higher notes, I still had a really important role with the second chair part to the songs we'd play in band. And so that ability to do something where, you know, typically you're hearing the melody out in the audience, that's something that just naturally you hear first, but at the same time, this idea of playing the secondary role is just as critical. And that was something that I was thinking about more as I was putting this together. And the idea of maybe not always being recognized for what one does being a really critical thing. This was a picture that I was able to come across that I'm really excited about, that I was able to find last night. We'll ignore that fact, though. This is my first grade teacher, Mrs. Morrow, from Saline Schools. I don't know, is anybody from Saline, by chance? Anybody know Mrs. Morrow? So this is a journey of how does somebody born from a family of farmers and a family of musicians, where do they find what they're going to do for their career? And I think my dad would also really credit it as well. He was really excited. He knew the teachers quite well and Mrs. Morrow. And so for me, I'm the younger sibling in my family. My sister, who skipped a grade, she was really quick with everything that she was able to do. She learned how to play the violin quite quickly. And so for me, it took me a little bit longer than my sister to be able to accomplish things. I didn't talk really until I was 3 years old. I wasn't quite as quick and active, I would say, as my sister as well at her age too. And so I don't know how quick, I was in speech class for quite a while as well, learning and trying more or less, I think, to catch up in certain dimensions of my life. And so Mrs. Morrow was a really inspirational person in my life because she really taught me to enjoy learning. And she really taught me to embrace and really celebrate the things that we're good at and to want to be good at things as well. There was this book, last year I read a book, and I'm sure others in the audience maybe have read it as well, How Children Succeed. And one of the stories from the book talks about students from a school who play chess and the value of playing chess. And in one of these schools, one of the low-income schools, coming from disadvantaged situations, just in the general term, they noticed that there was this individual, these students from one particular school that were just thriving in these chess tournaments, and there was a teacher who really, really, really encouraged and promoted and kept working with these students to keep playing chess and to keep doing this one thing really well. It gets into educational philosophy around in the U.S., how focused we are, how about having well-rounded students and being incorporated, doing sports, music, math, humanities, and I think, I mean, and that's a different conversation, I think, for a different night around that. But for me, I bring that up where, thinking about that, for me, Mrs. Morrow really encouraged me to be pursuing math. And math is something that I found as a real home for me, where something about those numbers, I don't know what, in terms of being able to multiply them. Anybody play Around the World back in the day in elementary school? Yeah, I see some hands. Good, they still play that. and so just being able to memorize those numbers and what the timetables are, bringing in my passion for sports and loving sports. So back in the day, you'd get the newspaper every morning, so there wasn't any ESPN, or at least a lot of people didn't have ESPN. And then on the farm, you kind of get the bunny ears for the TV sets. And so I learned about sports scores by looking at the box scores in the newspaper the following morning. And I remember going to that sports section and just looking at how many free throws did someone shoot, how many did they make, how many did they make out of how many, how many times did somebody in football carry a ball, and how many times did they rush. And I just remember any time I didn't know what a ratio percentage was, I got my calculator out and I started learning it and just started repetition. And I took a lot of pride in the fact of knowing what are the conversions of fractions to decimals and decimals to fractions and percentages. And I think having a teacher at such an early age be able to take somebody who more or less is trying to find their academic interests and find something to celebrate and be excited about in education, that's really had a profound impact on me and something that has meant a lot to me as I've progressed in my career. And so that more or less does, jumping ahead here, I did give teaching a shot here in the sense that I would have loved to have, what a privilege to have been a teacher, and I would have loved to have taught math in schools. This is me, my student teaching placement, which was in Milan High School. Any Milan grads? and I worked with Cindy Hasselbring, and it was a real treat to work with her as well. She wanted to work with NASA. She was passionate about NASA, and I think, and she works with NASA now. And I think for each of us, the fact that we found a place to incorporate math in our lives is what we really shared in common, and something that I think we had a lot of fun working together teaching. I love the idea of helping promote students' learning, the idea of being passionate about what you're doing in academics. For me, helping students learn not just how to solve math equations or how to use math, but also realizing math's importance and wanting to learn more. A side story here, a little bit of a soapbox issue. Part of me feels bad in terms of in math, because I feel like we really focus on repetition so much with math that we really don't get to where the fun can really start with math. And for our math majors in the crowd, excellent. Mathematical proofs, abstract algebra, that's really when you start to see what math can really do. And so for me, working with students to instill this passion for learning, really in math as well, is something that I really took a lot of pride in and something that I would have been happy doing. But at the same time, for me, something that had a really profound impact on me was my college experience. This is like the first of many. I already see, like, I remember my mentee here. So the top left picture is me and my mentee. I promise I didn't force him to do that. He encouraged me to do it. he was actually mentee of the year. I was involved with the first year mentor program. Like Becky said, I studied abroad in Switzerland, Italy, and Greece on the 36-day Mediterranean Cultural History Tour with Benita Goldman. My second mentee is Wealth Shaban. I see that picture once in a while in different brochures. We made that up on the spot. But, and also being an NSOA, it's always fun. I think the NSOA program is one of the coolest things that we have here, especially those bags, just seeing over the years the signatures, and I think you'll find, and I think I still, if someone showed me my signature this past year on the bag I used. I'm also participating in alternative spring breaks. I love the program. I think we're still doing it. We're South Carolina School for the Deaf and the Blind. Maybe go on that program by chance. And so for me, that was a really cool program that I went on, and I learned a lot about myself. I also really had the chance to think about how does one learn, how does one teach. For example, when I was there, I was teaching somebody how to solve linear equations who was deaf, and trying to communicate how to do mathematics without being able to communicate in one of the ways in which you most frequently communicate, that I was used to communicating with in teaching. That was a new experience for me as well. But the things that I was able to do, the things that I learned, the things that, as far as taking something like a discipline like math and how it incorporates beyond just the classroom setting and how it can permeate into different dimensions of your life, that was something that really made me want to keep working at a university. As an honor student, it's fun. I mean, right now it's kind of like, sometimes I feel like we live in the matrix here in the sense that we've been here before, we've done things before. We had a really flourishing and thriving student organization at the time that I was here as a student, the Honor Student Association. We did a lot of service activities. We were really involved on campus. We did a lot of really great stuff. The picture below that, the bottom right, that is a fundraising event that the director at the time, Dr. Knapp, and then the president at the time, John Fallon, we did a basketball fundraiser. Well, we did a fundraiser for SOS Community Services, where we actually raised over $5,500 by playing a basketball game, and every time the president scored a point, that was money donated to SOS. We went around, I think we were having it where it was like $32 or $33 a point scored in that game. Had a lot of vendors. It was a really exciting time. And also, so then on the left-hand side here is pictures from my experience at undergraduate symposium. The top left is my presentation, my first thesis, The Effectiveness of Electronic Whiteboards. And that was where I was looking at, so that was really in the late 2000, or 2006, 2008 area, where electronic whiteboards, I think a lot of you, well, I think there's a growing number of electronic whiteboards that are finding their way into classrooms now, but at the time, those were really few and far between. And really advocating for their value in the classroom was something that we were really trying to encourage my math professor and I. And so we did research on the board, what elements are important, how to have students interact with the board, how to have students really engage with the material that they're working with, having them come up to the board and use it themselves, the ability to save the files on the what was on the board, sending it out after the fact, and how students learn afterward as well. It was a really good good project and something that I'm really proud of as well. But the one that I really wanted to focus on, it was my bottom left one here. Some of you, so like Becky said, I did graduate with Departmental Honors in Literature, and I think that's kind of like the first thing, like, huh? So he's talking about secondary math ed and doing math and the value of math. And so the literature project is the one for me that really means a lot. As I like to say, Sandy Norton and I both like to say, we went to hell and back together writing this. The chance to really look at a text or text like we did, and the chance to really do something that maybe didn't directly impact or have a direct connection to how one becomes a math teacher, but what I did with that presentation or that project is what means so much to me. I also think in terms of what I've realized looking back on that assignment, I think back to what Dr. Doug Baker, if anybody's had him here at EMU, he and I had a conversation recently in terms of how people weigh pros and cons and what decisions to make in life. And for me, a lot of my life growing up, I thought about, right or wrong, tick for tack, and do the T-charts and measure one thing here, or think about a system of rules and equations as far as how does one get to making their decision. And so Dr. Baker talked to me about how there's research emerging about how people think about literature, and when they are faced with a decision to make, they think about common texts that they know and think about literary characters and what they did in given situations to come to the decisions that they came to. And I find that that's something that I'm doing more and more as I get older, as opposed to thinking about rules and rationalizing in the sense of point A to point B, thinking about context. And so for me, The thesis that I wrote on Giving the Devil His Due, The Evolution of a Fallen Hero, I think the one thing I do want to start off by saying is that this is about Satan in English literature. This really was lifting the character away from any religious biblical sense and really considering who Satan was portrayed in select texts in literature. The inspiration for me is one, and that's something that, you know, in terms of having the opportunity to even talk about it, you get kind of excited about. When I was putting this together, I talked about my presentation at symposium or my research at the undergraduate symposium, but the chance to really kind of pull that apart a little bit more. For me, I started off this presentation talking about career and interests and where one's going, because for me, deciding to go from secondary ed and this idea that I knew for a long time that I was going to teach, that was something that I had planned on doing for such a long time. I was voted back in high school, most likely to come back to Saline and be a teacher. This was just this prescribed life. Coming from a family of farmers, this idea that you're going to come back and maybe you'll deviate a little bit, but you'll find your way back to the farm. And this idea that you had to be something that maybe you didn't know was quite who you were supposed to be or what felt right to you. And so for me, there's this element of myself as far as feeling lost, feeling isolated, feeling like maybe this isn't what I'm supposed to be doing, and that having the ability to have faith in oneself and what one's feeling. I found my way into looking into, and I think that's something for me at the time, I wanted to try so hard to predict the future as far as what would be the best decision for me based on what would happen. And I think that's something that we find ourselves naturally doing quite a bit. And I actually took the moment, I was actually at the time reading Anne Rice's Mimnock the Devil, and I was thinking about the character Satan and portrayed in that literary text, and this idea of being misunderstood, being out of place, trying to find oneself. And so I wanted to look back in history, and I wanted to find somebody or something to connect to as far as somebody who has been here before. And I found my way to John Milton in the 1600s. And so Paradise Lost came in 1637, and it really was a reflection of John Milton's push and pull that he had with his religious faith, with his academic interest in philosophy, coming from a family of really religious individuals, at the time being a really religious time. Milton really wanted to find a way to express his feelings and the tension that he was feeling about more or less leaving his culture and becoming someone new. And so Satan in Paradise Lost was never meant to be this heroic character. It was really meant to be a reflection of when one goes too far with making too many bad decisions or gets too self-consumed. But what happened is, as we progressed into the Romantic period, we had authors and philosophers looking at Satan from Paradise Lost and really identifying heroic traits in the earlier parts of the book of somebody who had a lot of courage, the ability to think for oneself, the ability to go against the grain. And so people at the time, they really looked to this character in literature as more as an example of how to go against power in society. And the idea that, and then the character later evolved into more text. Lord Byron wrote a text, Cain, where the heroic traits from Paradise Lost, Satan, really emerged and came full circle as an individual that you could really relate to. I think the text, when talking about Satan in this English literature sense, it's not so much, and this is more or less the thesis that I was getting at in my text, is it's not so much as what this devil did, right or wrong, good or bad. It's what would you have done differently? And that was really the question that I was exploring in that, because it's a matter of eventually Satan does fall, and that's more or less the story of Paradise Lost, is the fall of Satan. But how does one personify themselves through this character? And for me, that was finding a connection at that time in my life to find something to give me the courage to go on and do something differently than what was expected of me. That really meant a lot. And that's where I think that one of the things that I get really excited about when we talk about the humanities here at college is the value of looking back. This idea that, sure, maybe we have an original feeling or we have something that we feel is an original feeling, but we've had a lot of people on this planet, and there's a lot of people who've gone through similar things. And yes, the shades of gray and the context does change over the years, But going back and finding a connection to somebody in different century through a fictional character, that really means a lot to me. And for me, that's something that I look back on and I'm really proud of, because it also, it really taught me the value of research. I mean, the topic itself, I remember going to recruiting functions and the director would be like, oh, John, what do you, tell us about your honors experience. Well, I'm writing this thesis on the devil, and like the prospective family going, let alone the director going, And so I think the other thing here is the appreciating the fact that at a university, it's such a privilege to come somewhere, to have the chance to put thoughts and ideas on paper around something like this. In a safe place where you can share ideas and share and explore and maybe not know quite where you're going to find yourself, but in the end, the journey of how you got there is going to shape you to who you are. And so that's why I take a lot of pride in this thesis that I wrote, and it represents so much to me. And I read it, and the last page, it really means a lot to me, this idea of finding the heroic traits within the clouds. Of Satan. But for me, what it really showed is what one can do in higher ed and why working in higher ed is so valuable and why promoting learning and the chance to do things beyond just vocational tasks as far as how do I best prepare for this one particular job that I think I want to do today that I don't know if I'm going to want to do tomorrow. And I think being prepared to adapt and morph to your given circumstance is something that I think really is at the, having that curiosity is at one of the pillars that we stand on in honors at the university in general as well. I did go to U of M afterwards for my master's degree in higher ed, leaving the opportunity to go on and work right away. I remember in my grad program, we're all working really hard and doing all the studying, and I remember everybody talking about their degrees, like, well, I didn't know if I was going to be able to find a job with this, and then they got to me, like, why don't you want to be a teacher? You work so hard for that degree, and you could be making money right now, and why are you putting yourself through it? And for me, the thesis, being involved on campus, the idea of having faith in yourself to invest beyond just thinking about the next day, but thinking about the long term, and maybe that things don't make sense at that given moment, but it will come together in the end. That's something that I'm so grateful for. Some of the pictures from our Facebook page, as far as things that I've been involved with and done with our Honors College here today, things that I'm so proud of, I'm so glad that I could be a part of. And so I lay that as the first identity to focus that I want to talk about as far as my career path, because I think within there, there's this idea of assumption of who you were supposed to be, maybe what you thought you were supposed to be, and ultimately where you end up getting and how does one get there. That lays kind of the context for my next two identities that I'm going to talk about. Last year I did a talk at Storytellers, no, it was last year, two years ago, Storytellers Lounge, on becoming a vegan. And so that's something that, so now I've been a practicing vegan for 3 years, almost 3 years, Lauren, 3 years, 3 years. we lose track at this point. So I start off, of course, naturally what you would think would be the image for a vegan is this burger. Basement Burger Bar in Farmington. Has anybody been there? Yes. Okay, so Lauren and I were with some friends one night, and we went to this bar, this Basement Burger Bar, and so I saw the menu, and this is pre-vegan, that's disclaimer, and we were trying to figure out what toppings to get, and I said, is it possible to get all the toppings on a burger? And that includes the 10 different cheeses, the cranberries, the jalapeno kickers, the cheese sticks, all the standard stuff on it, and so they said, well, let me check the manager. And so next thing we know, here comes the manager with this camera and this burger and this bowl. And somewhere in this basement apparently is my picture with this burger. And so for me, I was thinking about that and what maybe people are thinking, man, of course that's why you went vegan after eating that thing. But really what it is for me, I took this picture A because I thought it was a fun story, but B, when I was in school, I realized that I needed to do something differently about myself. And so focusing specifically on this vegan diet is something for me that's been a really big thing of my life the last few years, because coming from a family of farmers, talking about that earlier, going on a vegan diet is just something that's not typical, I would say, something that my dad reminds me every time he has a chance to. but for me, I knew I had to do something a little bit differently because having been involved in school and athletics and all this stuff, working out, exercising, that was just something that just wasn't something that I could do as often or as well as I was getting older. And so for me, the chance to try to do something differently when I couldn't do something about my physical activity, or that, and at the time I was recovering from an injury, I wanted to do something that I could do that would maybe help live a healthier life than what I was at the time. My family, we have a history of medical issues, specifically with the heart in my family. My grandpa passed away of a heart attack before I met him. My dad, and when I was in first grade, when he was 39 years old, he had his first heart attack. A couple of years later, he had his second. And then when I was in eighth grade, he had his third heart attack, which also led to his triple bypass surgery as well. And as one gets older, and now in my 30s, you start to think about how close 39 is coming. And for me, I really wanted to do everything that I could to try to be around as long as I could be as well. And so, perusing BarnesandNoble.com, like I do once in a while, I came across this book entitled The End of Diabetes, which was the number two seller at the time, and I was really excited because I was like, oh, I'm going to be that person who's going to be like, oh, you haven't heard of this book, it's the number two seller, and I said, oh, it's going to be great, and then the next day I look and it's gone, and I'm like, well, darn. But at the same time, I saw that title, The End of Diabetes, and to me that seemed like such an oxymoron and a contradiction, because for me, from my experience, my dad is a diabetic at this time. I never knew that there was such a thing as having the end of diabetes for an individual. I thought once one had it, you had it, and that was something you were going to have for the rest of your life. Since then, I've learned through reading that when one is type 2 diabetic, that you can take different lifestyle changes and dietary changes to at least minimize the effects of being a type 2 diabetic to the end of potentially having it really be not something that impacts your life. And so for me, when I started this, and I identified starting this vegan diet at the time when we were starting it, I wanted to think about how I could do something that could show my dad how he could do something with his life that would maybe impact his lifestyle choices to keep him around as long as I could as well. My wife and I, we kind of, after the holidays, which is always a perfect time to think about, boy, maybe we need to do some lifestyle changes, we decided to start off being a vegetarian in February 2013, and we just noticed how we were finding our way closer and closer to finding our way to a vegan diet. And I think, remembering this time as opposed to the last time I did this, a vegan diet is one where you do not have animal products in your diet. So that means no meat, no dairy, no eggs, no cheese, and so doing this, you learn a lot about having to keep track of what you're eating. And so that was something new for Lauren and I as we were shopping for things as far as looking at nutritional labels, looking at ingredients, trying to figure out, can I eat that? Can I not eat that? And what becomes really fun as a vegan is when you're going out with people and like you're sitting down at the restaurant and you're just looking over and you're just looking through that menu and you're just trying to find anything that you can eat. And sometimes it turns into pico de gallo and tortilla chips, which of course is me in the spirit of the vegan diet in itself. But at the same time, sometimes that's what you get. And so it's also, when one's a vegan, you always kind of, you're seeing in anticipation if you're going out to eat and you see like the waiter or the waitress coming up to you, and because you're coming, you wonder, oh man, am I going to be their first vegan customer that they've ever had before? And so you start off by saying, well, I'm a vegan, and so sometimes I've gone out and it's kind of like, well, we have this wonderful cheese pizza, we have these scrambled eggs you can have, and always having to explain what is a vegan diet, or what does it mean, or what can I have, what can I not have, and especially for me, seeing my, the story of sharing it with my dad for the first time, we went out to eat with my parents for my mom's birthday, and at the time, Laura and I hadn't told my parents that we were trying this vegan diet, And I remember, like, so we're at Outback Steakhouse, the perfect place for a vegan to be. Yeah, I tried to be like, well, how about, and that didn't go over too well. So anyways, so here we are at Outback Steakhouse, and I ask the waiter, can we get steamed vegetables with our salad as opposed to the chicken? And I remember my dad looking at me thinking, what the hell is he whispering over there? And so when the waiter comes back out with this bowl of steamed vegetables and literally just dumps the veggies onto the salad in front of my whole family, my dad just goes, what the hell are you doing? And at that point, I had to explain to him, I was kind of cornered at that point. I just thought I'd try this out. This looks so good next to those porterhouse steaks. So having the chance to talk to my dad about why we were doing this, what we were trying to accomplish with it, maybe some things that he could incorporate into his lifestyle, he did give it a shot here for a little bit. Now being years, the story was much more inspirational at the time. Being a couple years later, he did give it a try a little bit, just was not cut out for him, not going vegan, but at least minimizing or trying to make better health decisions that he has. But since the presentation, I have this picture, and I had this picture on the first slide as well, because this was my birthday present 1 year from my parents, and these are vegan cupcakes from the Cupcake Factory. So you can find these if you do try to have a vegan diet. But I thought I'd have this slide here just in place of, well, so don't you ever miss having a hamburger, or don't you ever want to have some meat or something like that? And so when people ask me that question, I think the best example I can think of for that is like kind of like thinking you want a beer during the middle of the day, during the work week. And it's kind of like, I could go out and I could go get that beer, but I probably shouldn't because I probably would have consequences if I do. And that's really not the best thing to do for my long-term standing at the university. Disclaimer, I did not do that. I have not done that. But the ability to think about a decision and its impact beyond the given time, that was something that I've learned from this, and I'll come back to. But the second question is, well, how do you find anything to eat? Well, that's sometimes a really good question. But you do get creative, and I think what here, we are kind of spoiled here in Washtenaw County, in Southeast Michigan, but Washtenaw County specifically, where we do have a lot of good options for somebody who has a dietary restriction. Or an allergy, and finding things that you can eat. And so I bring up this vegan, being a vegan, coming from a family of farmers, an extended family members, they're the number one or two dairy farmers in the state, coming from farmers, you know, my mom and dad and discussed with me, well, you're bankrupting farmers. You're not eating enough meat. Well, you know, there's these things called corn and oats and wheat, and you know, we do eat those still. And one of my favorite stories now at this point is talking to my dad. So my dad does give me a hard time, but he does kind of embrace the fact that, yeah, this is kind of what Laura and I are doing at this point. But one of my favorite stories is, I think it was last year. So my dad's always a little leery as far as what he's going to eat. I don't know why he's scared of vegan food, but he is for whatever reason. And so, like, he was over at our house having a fruit salad one day, and I said, well, watch out, Dad, those are vegan grapes. Ooh, I knew it. I knew there was something funny about these. And, you know, we had a good laugh about it. But at the same time, for me, coming from the farm, being involved in sports where the idea of, like, eat meat, eat lots of protein, finding out that there's different ways one can eat protein, and I would say at this point, when I was initially doing this, I would say I was on a vegan diet, but at this point I would say I am a vegan, and that is one of the more salient identities that I do have at this point in my life. I don't know if I'll always be a vegan, and Laura and I talk about that regularly. Maybe sometimes it's tempting to become a cheetotarian, as I say with Laura, but at the same time, it's something where, not sure if this is something I'll do forever, not sure if it's something I'll always be, but at the same time right now, it's something that is a big part of my life. So the last part here is the last identity that I'm focusing on, and this was the most challenging one for me, but it's also one that has the most meaning for me as well. I termed this guardian, and I didn't know quite what I wanted to label it. Somewhere between, so this is the idea of raising something, raising someone, and part of the evolution of the story, or part of what I'm talking about in this identity, for me is the idea of how I perceived what I was more or less raising. Growing up on the farm, again, the recurring theme here, having a certain lifestyle and having this certain way in which the way the world works, the purpose of or what you're doing, working with animals regularly, taking great care of animals for a particular purpose. And so for me, I was involved with 4-H for a long time in my life. And that's always something I like to have the chance to call and say, is anybody involved in 4-H or was involved in 4-H? Excellent. So I was involved in 4-H for 13 years. And growing up on the farm, being born in a family of farmers, that's just something that I was going to be involved in, and I was involved in. I'm really glad that I was. I learned a lot working with my dad. My dad, especially when I was younger, helped quite a bit. That's my generous way of saying sometimes he did almost a lot of it as far as helping raise the animals for 4-H. And so 4-H, there's typically fairs where you're raising an animal for a particular for a specific purpose of taking it to a fair. And showing it, there's different elements to fairs as far as competitions where you're showing a pig. There's a few different pictures of me here with some of the pigs I had over the years. There's different parts to the fair where it's how are you showing the animal, how well are you showing it. There's other parts to it that the animal becomes the focus as far as how the quality of the animal, is it going to be good for market purposes, is it going to be an animal that's going to bring a good price when selling it. And so the different parts of that all kind of come together in raising an animal for 4-H or fair purposes. I really enjoyed being involved in 4-H and raising animals because it had a chance for me to connect with my dad. He was involved in 4-H. It was one of the most meaningful things of his life. He won sweepstakes at our local county fair, which means that he was identified as the best show person that year. Once you get it, you're kind of retired at that point, so it's a really big deal. And so I wanted to be my dad. So they had it long enough where my dad was involved in it, but there had never been a second generation of family on that trophy. And so it would have meant a lot to me to have been the first family members to have two people on it. But unfortunately, that wasn't something I was able to do. But at the same time, I bring that up where for me, growing up and working with these animals for so many years, every year I would have four pigs for one show, four sheep for another, and four pigs for a different show. And so doing that for years, I raised a lot of different animals. And hundreds. And so you raise them for typically about 4 to 5 months. And at the end of those 4 to 5 months, you know what's coming. It's goodbye. And you say bye at that time. And it's kind of this unset agreement that you know what you're getting into before you start. And you do that time and time again, that I think you raise your walls high enough to not let anything creep in too far. Because you don't want to feel that sting of saying bye. And so for me, I gained a lot. I think the animals I raised, and I remember a lot of their names and what they meant and the memories that we have together and the memories I have of my dad. But at the same time, coming from the farm and this the mentality of it's time to say goodbye, that was something that I grew up with and was used to. But then this little girl came into our lives, and this is Bonkers. Yes, that is Randy Orton behind us there. That's a different story for a different night for our WWE fans in the crowd. But we came from, I was raised with dogs, and so we have different farm dogs, and I bought a cat. My God, what the heck? what do you do with a cat? And so Bonkers, it's one of those things, I should have looked the stat up before tonight, but the percentage of cats that find you versus you finding them. So Bonkers found her way onto our apartment steps when we were in college. And Lauren always loves to share the fact that I was one that let Bonkers out every night, trying to let her find her home. And she likes to talk about how she rescued her and that I was the mean person trying to kick her out. But eventually we got Bonkers, and she's still with us today. And so one of the things, so I feel like when you talk to somebody while they're in grad school, everybody has like a grad school pet project that they work on the side, trying to like keep their sanity in place. And so when we started grad school, that was the perfect time for Lauren and I. Well, we watched Meet the Parents. And so of course, I hear somebody knows where this is going. And so we thought, and so in Meet the Parents, they potty trained their cat. And Lauren and I on our grad school budget thought, you know, I wonder if we could cut out kitty litter and potty train our cat. And so right when we were starting grad school, we got bonkers almost to the point, and we felt like she was getting really close to being able to do it. But then we met this guy on our left here, Jasper, who we said, well, bonkers, it'd be so nice if bonkers had a playmate or somebody to be with as well. And so Jasper here, he really, he loved people. We tried to get him potty trained as well, and so that's where you take this bowl, you put it in the toilet, it's got a little bit of litter in it, and you put him on there, put him on the toilet, and say, okay, you can go now. And so Bonkers knew what we wanted her to do, but Jasper, he was just so excited to see us that he just flopped in the kitty litter, and we just thought, oh God, wait, this isn't gonna work. But the point is that when we met Jasper and we adopted Jasper when he was a year and a half, he loved people, and something that he loved being around people, and he especially loved being around people during thunderstorms because he was absolutely terrified of thunderstorms. And one of my favorite stories with Jasper is that he was also a door cat, meaning that like as soon as the door opened, he tried to bolt out. And so when we had friends come over one night, we realized that we were watching the movie, went to bed, we came back from work the next day, and all of a sudden we couldn't find Jasper, and we found out that he had been outside for the last 26 hours in this thunderstorm, and terrified, and we came across him, but he didn't leave, he was waiting for us to come get him, and he came back inside. For us, Jasper really meant a lot to us because he was involved in so many of the things that we did every day. And for us, what we had Jasper for about 6 years, and that when we started realizing that he wasn't moving around quite as much, and that he was, we thought maybe he's just a little sick, we're not quite sure. We actually came back one morning, actually when I was at work, Lauren found Jasper not moving really much at all, and we had to take him to the vet, and after doing a series of tests and figuring out what was going on, we realized that he either had lymphoma or FIP, and I forget the acronym of what that is, but essentially that just means that less than a month or two. And so for me, for the sake of time, trying to jump ahead just a little bit here, I realized in that moment that we had a really big decision on our hands to make. Jasper really meant a lot to us in the sense that, let me keep saying Lauren. So Lauren, my wife, who is here tonight, we don't have children of our own, and I think that's also another, just in terms of how we view our situation. But at the same time, coming from a family of farmers and having a way in which you raise animals, and I think owning, the owner of, is the way in which a person typically identifies themselves with farm animals in the typical sense. But at the same time, for Lauren and I, we really realized that our feelings had evolved into something with this cat where it wasn't just we're the owners of a cat. We really felt like we were parents and that we more or less had to say farewell to our son. And so this picture, what I have here, is a picture of me and Jasper minutes before our veterinarian arrived. We consulted with the veterinarians as far as how to best handle the situation, and kind of came, when we came to the conclusion of it was best for him that we had to say goodbye. I have this picture up. I think for Lauren and I, we really view our life as we have an August 8th, 2014 life before that, and we have an August 8th, 2014 life after this, because of how much he meant to us in our relationship. And so for me, this picture really represents a lot. This is something that Lauren snuck in. I didn't even know at the time that she did it. I remember this moment vividly where I thought about how much I was upset and hurt that I thought I had something that was going to carry me to my 40s, and that wasn't going to be the case. I was also upset with myself because I thought about all the times that I just blew past Jasper to get to my work and do what I needed to do that night and what I thought was really important. And so for me in this moment, the only thing I was thinking about was him and just trying to swallow up every moment that I had with him right then and there. And I thought about my thesis and after the fact in terms of what this meant for me as far as another part that my thesis helped me with as far as thinking about the moment and appreciating our time that we have here and the people that we have around us, because this is where we are, this is who we are, and this is what we have. And so for me, this picture represents me truly being in the moment, knowing that this wasn't going to last forever, but something that was always going to mean a lot to me. And so with the conflicts of the identity here, the theme of it is that this is the push and pull between parenthood and ownership, I guess it would be the term, and really more or less accepting the fact that for me, I do feel like I am a dad. I feel like I did have a son, and unfortunately, I don't have him here now. But at the same time, this encounter and this experience, I think about how much my education and writing this thesis and what I've been able to learn from the text that I've read to help me through this. And I think that's what I'll get to here at the end. We love Jasper in the sense, because of so many reasons, of course of who he was, but something that one of Lauren's classmates brought up one time, not regarding this, was the small everyday things that mean the most to us. And that's so true. because for us, so many of the things, as far as kneeling down to pet a cat, to having a cat on your lap, to try to say no, Jasper, as far as letting a cat run out the door, or cat drinking from the toilet, as I think we have pictured in here as well. No, Jasper, don't do that. then don't lick me afterwards, please. With his tongue clearly out, ready to go in the next slide. or sleeping on you as well. These are things that you just kind of realize that mean the most, and sometimes you miss the most too. There's a quote I have here from Emily Pearl Kingsley, a writer for Sesame Street. When you're going to have a baby, it's like planning a fabulous vacation trip to Italy. You buy a bunch of guidebooks, make wonderful plans, the Colosseum, the Michelangelo David, the gondolas in Venice. You may learn some handy phrases in Italian. It's all very exciting after months of eager anticipation. The day finally arrives. You pack your bags and off you go. Several hours later, the plane lands. The stewardess comes in and says, "Welcome to Holland." And what I really like, and so I bring that up in the sense that when I was younger, thinking about being a parent, thinking about what my son would look like, I never would have anticipated that he would have had four paws and a tail. But at the same time, that's how much he meant to me, and I know that's how much he meant to Lauren as well. So summing it up here, as far as lessons, pulling away, I broke it down into different ones from the different themes that I talked about tonight. I touched on it already for the professional, visualizing where you're going and having a plan to get there. And I think that, and that comes back to thinking about when I was in football, and more or less just accepting. I know sometimes, and the people who work with me, I think they'll realize this as well. Sometimes things, having to react to something on the spot, that's just not necessarily my forte. I need some time to process. I need some time to think about it. I need the ability to visualize it. Those who've worked with me at orientation, Lacey, I'm looking at you, know how much I like to walk through the day and visualize what I'll be doing. And I think that's just something as far as what I encourage people to do, as far as visualize how you plan to get to where you're going. And every day you have the chance to take one step closer to doing that. Not being recognized. And that comes back to being in music and maybe not necessarily having your individual instrument heard in the performance, but knowing that you have a part to play. You know, one of my family members once asked me, isn't it great, or isn't it so rewarding to know that you recruit so many people to come to EMU? And I told them, if I do my job right, they'll never know I was even there. And my job isn't to have people come to the school because of me. It's my job to hold the lens for people to see this university and this Honors College for the best that it can be and what it can represent and represent for the individuals as well. It's too bad my picture's a little too small here. Being okay that your life isn't gonna go as planned. I've worked with so many of you, and maybe I haven't had a chance to work with you one-on-one, but we know about you, and we're working hard for you, and we're thinking about you. And I know right now with the economic times that we have and the cost of college that so many of the decisions that we make, we're just trying so hard to get from point A to point B as efficiently and economically as possible. And I know it can be really scary to think about the investment in these tangents, viewed tangents in the sense that maybe they're not absolutely required of you to do. But positive experiences, no matter what shape or form they take for you in your given situation, a positive experience is going to impact you on ways. And maybe it's not going to make sense in that given day. But years later, you're going to look back and you're going to say, man, that was one of the best things I ever did. I think about the internship in the president's office that I had. I learned so much from that experience. I'm becoming a better math teacher. I can pull elements from it. And if it was an interview, I could pull those things to it. But at the same time, it prepared me for something that I never even knew I could do. Writing the thesis about Satan. I mean, not exactly what I was going to bring up during my math teacher interviews, but at the same time, becoming a scholar, appreciating scholarship more from the experience, learning. And I think for me, that's one of the things that I want to point out, because I don't get a chance to talk about it in honors in my traditional job sense. I think sometimes we think of a thesis as a way to mark off and put a checkbox next to a requirement to graduate with a certain distinction. Isn't that going to make me look so much better on paper? And sure, maybe it will. And maybe this, that being on your piece of paper, that will make or break the difference as far as getting to a next step. What I would say, as always, it's about how you make it meaningful. I'll get to that at the end here. The second part is maybe you want to contribute to your field of study, and that's great. And adding new content to an area, being recognized, being published, presenting at a conference, of course, that's what we want for you. But I think something that I don't talk about enough, and something that I think I want to start talking about more, is what you can discover about yourself through writing a thesis and writing scholarship. And so for me, that's really what my thesis means for me, is what did I discover about myself? And even if it didn't have an impact on me at the time, it really has meant a lot to me now. And embracing your inner self. I love working here at a university. I remember working in schools and high schools, and this idea of having to be Mr. Feldkamp from 7:30 to 2, and then being John from 2 to whatever time I went to bed, as far as being the chance to put all of yourself together and being who you are. I'm not a farmer. I don't think at this point I will be a farmer, and that's okay. I think that's really kind of more or less accepting that my interest resides somewhere else and just loving who you are for who you are. Lifestyle, so regarding the vegan diet, evaluating needs versus wants, and that's something that I always focus on and talk about with being a vegan, as far as do I really need to eat this thing or do I just really want to eat this thing? And of course, I'd love to say it always wins out as far as what do I need to eat in this, but at the same time, thinking about your daily decisions like that more and more, there's this famous marshmallow test that they have that I forget what year it was done, but as far as like examining students, I think it was in kindergarten, students were presented the opportunity of you can either have one marshmallow now, or if you wait 5 minutes, you can have two in 5 minutes. And so they found that those who were able to wait 5 minutes and have two actually had more rewarding life outcomes, such as higher SAT scores, educational attainment, BMI, other life measures as well. And I think for me, thinking about needs versus wants, that's something that has, going on this journey of being a vegan has really helped me with that as well. And embracing patience. I think right now, again, back to the spirit of there's so much that we can go out and do right now, and how am I ever going to do all these things that I want to do and that I'm working so hard to do? But being able to wait and smell the roses, there are opportunities that are available to you here in college that you should be pursuing or that you could have the chance to pursue that would really make impacts that you may not even know exist right now. And I think here on the last slide, the guardian category that I have, the co-occupations. Lauren and I were just recently at a conference, and there was a couple who was married for 36 years. And so one of the people in the crowd asked, how do you have a successful marriage for 36 years? What's the secret? And he said, co-occupations. And doing joint things together, having shared experiences, being with Jasper, having this journey with my wife raising Jasper, it's brought us together in so many ways. And on this slide, if nothing else, it's an excuse to have a blast from the past here. I can see that Lauren's putting her head down with it. But these are pictures from Lauren and I when we first met each other in 2004 here on this campus. Yes, that's another WWE shirt. the trend here, boy, that's not what I was putting together here. Maybe that should have been the theme. But at the same time, Lauren and I, we've had a great time here at this university. This university's provided us with 3 degrees, jobs, opportunity, and it's been a real pleasure going on this journey with her as well. And all the support through even just writing this, going through this, evolving, trying to find the identity and who I am. I'm really grateful and happy that I have such a great partner doing this with me. So this is my last slide here, and some lines here. I'm not the son I was born to be, and I'm not the professional I thought I'd be. I'm not on the diet I ever thought I could be on. However you do the best that you can with who you are, and even if you didn't know who you were before, and in terms of what identity you're wearing and what circumstance, when you put it all together, you have what you have, and you try to pursue the best life that you can with the identities that are with you. I don't know if these identities are always going to be my most salient, my most germane, the ones that I identify most quickly with. I always think of the five finger exercise as far as like which identities mean the most to you. But for me, I was actually writing this, putting this presentation together. I guess my last two things I'll say here is, Laura and I, we feel like we lost a big part of our puzzle a couple years ago, and that really stuck with me as far as, so what does that mean? I lost a big part of my puzzle, and it's missing, and I don't know if I'm ever going to get it back. But for me, writing this, I think what I've realized is that maybe I was staring too closely at the puzzle pieces, and maybe I thought I was working with a 200-piece puzzle, and maybe actually what I have is a 1,000-piece puzzle in front of me. And that doesn't mean that the pieces that we're missing aren't. They still are. We still feel like they are. But we also have other puzzle pieces in our life as well that we put all of our love and interest in as well. And that was actually one of the last pieces of advice that the veterinarian offered us as we were saying bye to Jasper, and the importance of taking your psychology and sociology classes as those who want to go into vet school. Love your cat. You love Bonkers, and Bonkers being our other cat, and put all your love into her. And so we have done that. And so we do have new puzzle pieces here as well. Bottom left, this is Maddie. He is our youngest cat in the family. And in the top right, this is actually a picture hot off the press. This is Scotty. And though that would be drool all over his whiskers, I think he has a crush on Lauren. especially when she's doing homework. And so every night when we go to bed, I would say every other night we go to bed, I just hear this and just getting closer and closer to Lauren, and then he just sits there and stares at Lauren. It's really, and Scotty actually has crossed eyes, and so like he has this really focused look too when he's looking at her. I don't know if he's like thinking he's gonna eat her. I don't know what he's got going on, but he's just drooling, just waterwork. And Lauren's, my favorite story for Lauren is that drooling so much that sometimes if you're lucky enough, he'll drool in your hand, he'll wake you up. If you're really lucky, he'll drool in your mouth and wake you up. But at the same time, for us, I think it's more or less not forgetting the puzzle pieces that used to be there, not just focusing on the ones that aren't, but knowing that there are ones still here, and that there are puzzle pieces that we're still looking for, and that we're still looking forward to adding to our life story. And I think my last thing I'll just say here, and this is just something that I really wanted to say, is that I did graduate from U of M, I didn't know what I was gonna go on and do. Kind of in higher ed, you kind of go for what you can with the jobs that are there. And so for me, I went into career counseling at U of M at the College of Engineering. I had never visited a career counseling office. I had never been an engineer, but hey, it still worked out for my first job, and I really did enjoy it. but when the opportunity came back to come back to EMU, I was really excited about the opportunity. Not so much about, I had a great entry-level job, and going from an entry-level job in higher ed to an assistant director job, that was a great opportunity financially as well. But I didn't come back for the money. I encourage you, as you're thinking about what jobs you want to pursue, don't do things for money. There's lots of ways you can make money. And if you want to make money, if that's the most important thing to you, there will always be a way to make a lot of money. Make money, maybe a lot too. But I didn't come back here for that. The Honors College meant a lot to me in my time here at school, and I hope that's something that's evident from my presentation tonight. I wanted to come back and help. I wanted to come back, and I didn't want to recreate experiences for students that I had myself. I wanted to help create experiences that had just as much meaning for students as they had for me. But even more than that, more than increasing any kind of, having access to the Honors College is something that Becky and I have taken a lot of pride in for the last 5 years, is providing students opportunities, whether it be to get into be a student in the Honors College, to the things you can do in the Honors College. I wanted to come back, and I wanted to change what it meant to be a smart person. That's what motivated me to come back here. I felt, well, not during my time, people were really bashful. They were really shy about their academics. They were shy about doing well in their classes. They were shy about having passions and things that weren't just standard norm pop culture. I knew at the time students were embarrassed of their honor shirts. They didn't like to take them out. They didn't like to put them on. I wanted to tell people I'm in the Honors College. And that was something that I wanted to change. And more importantly than the honors credits, the community service hours, the honors experiences, those requirements are there for a reason. I think in terms of analogy, the best one that I could think of is paper mache, that they're the paper mache that we're putting around you to help stand you up and build you up for something more as an academic and as a scholar. But when you take away the paper mache and you take away the requirements and you're left freestanding and left there, what we hope that you find is that you've changed, maybe found things about yourself that you didn't know were there before, and that they were there all along, and you just needed help finding those things within yourself. And for me, thinking back on being somebody who just loved math, and having a teacher and a role model as somebody who really wanted to celebrate the fact that I was really good at something with academics. That's something that we hope to provide students here, is a place to be celebrated for academic achievement, to be motivated to learn new things about yourself and your interests. And curiosity, that is something that that is one of the things that we're most proud of in Honors, is being curious with what you're doing, and also having the grit and determination to keep that curiosity going, not just to graduate with Honors, but to maintain that for the rest of your life, because you just don't know where you're going to be. And you don't know what pieces are in your puzzle quite yet. They may change, and they may be new ones added over the years as well. But I'm so proud of what we've been able to accomplish with our time here in Honors. I'm so proud of the work that we see students. I knew I made it with my goal for having students be proud when I go to a football game and I see all the Honors College shirts and I see the hoodies, and that brings a smile to my face, because that makes me think about all of the things that we've done to help students be really proud of the fact of what they're doing with their time in college. So thank you for taking the time to hear my story. I know I'm supposed to leave time for questions. I know it's a little later than I anticipated, but I want to thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I really do appreciate it.